Hi, my name is James. I'm a whisky maker for Compass Box, and I'm very excited to be standing here today with Mannie Monaghan, our winner of the Circle 2019, to talk about the whisky he helped us create.
Hi, I'm Mannie Monaghan. I'm the owner and creative director of Below Stairs Cocktail Bar in Leeds.
The Circle is our international bartending program. It started in 2018. And we had our second edition in 2019, and our winner was Mannie. And it is a way of getting the bartending community, who are used to blending spirits, being very, very creative, together with us as whisky makers who also combine things, but usually whiskies, to have a bit of creative play in exchange. So when Mannie came to us with the idea for the Synesthesia whisky, it was the night after you'd been announced as the winner. There was a lot of samples that we'd set up, thinking we could go down this direction, we could go down that direction. And I basically sort of had to take a step back. I had to say, well, I'm not synesthetic, so what are these whiskies showing you, and are they getting us closer?
Synesthesia is essentially the sensation of experiencing multiple senses together from an individual stimulus. It's a portmanteau of two Greek words which kind of mean experience together or perform together. It manifests in a lot of different ways for a lot of different people, but it's actually not that uncommon. About 1 in 2,000 people have it. Some people have it in very, very pronounced, strong ways. So something as simple as like the number 3 could make them actually visually see the color blue, for instance. It's a lot more common with music. So there's a lot of famous composers down the time, like Sibelius was kind of believed to be a synesthete. I think Pharrell Williams has said that he experiences it. For me, it's connected with flavor and color. I'm not like an out and out synesthete, so it's not like every time I taste something, I get really vivid color, but it is something I experience a lot with spirits and cocktails and food that's kind of powerful. It's something I've almost kind of trained. It came instinctively, and then I'm like, that's actually a really interesting creative outlet for me. So then it was something that I actively try to focus on more and to kind of develop in my own mind, to the point now where it's pretty much whenever I taste something in my mind's eye, I have a really kind of distinct color impression of it.
Can you remember the first time that someone was like, oh, that's interesting, that doesn't happen for me? The first time you sensed that you were a little bit unusual?
Well, I remember the first time it happened, but I didn't really think anything of it, and it was only kind of years later when I was thinking about it, the first time I remember it happened. And it was on a family holiday when I must have been 12 or 13, something like that, maybe a bit younger even. And we went down to Cornwall and stayed in a caravan and went surfing every day, like learning to surf, which is exhausting. And I think this was kind of part of it. It was like stimulating on sensory level. And then in the evening, we went to this like little local pub where they made like Moules Marinier. Tasting the Moules Marinier was the first time I really was like, as I was eating it, I'm like, this is yellow with green and blue kind of floating around the edges. That's the first time I can really remember it vividly happening. And then I think it just kind of went on a back burner until I really started getting into making cocktails. And that was the next time it really became quite a pronounced thing for me. And I think it's why I've chosen a career in cocktails, yeah, which is going on 16 years now.
So that was a really special process for me to work on, because I had to give up a lot of control. And you know, I wasn't with the company super long. I was maybe 9 months into the job, but you get to know the samples and you understand what's where. So basically I became a bit of a, you know, someone who goes and retrieves and pours for Mannie and what are you getting? And actually gradually with that process, I started to get a sense for what you would think would be closer. So when we started talking about flavor, and you would say, oh, well, yeah, maybe we want something a little bit more savory. And then, okay, so we're in the sherry style. We're going, I know we can go to the back of, you know, this room and we can pick up some samples, which might get us closer. So the idea was just so appealing, and it took a little bit of a mental leap, I suppose, to gradually find the key.
I think we definitely, like, especially by the end of the session, it developed a bit of a kind of common language as well. So when I was like thinking, okay, we need a bit more of this color, like I could describe that, and we kind of found like, oh, well, these types of malts seem to be on this spectrum of, yeah, color and stuff like that. And it was really fun for me to be like, James, you know, I need something that's like kind of like, you know, like really bright red strawberry, but with like a hint of this on the side. And you're like, yes, that one. Straight away. So yeah, that was really cool.
It became quite intuitive by the end. And actually, genuinely, looking back on it now, I feel as though, certainly by the end of that first session, I was starting to see the colour. I was sort of borrowing your synesthetic vision, and that was quite cool. It's since faded, unfortunately, but
Just keep cultivating it.
Exactly. But it was a lot of fun to look at our samples in a completely different way.
The Circle Bartending Program. There is an opportunity to be involved with Compass Box Whiskey over the course of a year, learning, getting creative, collaborating with other kind of passionate cocktail bartenders and whiskey makers. And just generally having a very good time. And you're very lucky, you get to make your own whiskey.
We really want it to be a way for the bartending world and the world of whiskey makers to sort of creatively get together, have those conversations, because we're about blending, but if you're making cocktails, that's blending also. So there's all sorts of ideas and traditions that we can sort of feed off. And I think that's what the Circle program has definitely been for the two opportunities we've had to actually do it with everything else. But yeah, that's what it is. That's why we set it up.
From like a bartender's perspective, we see a lot of brands, especially cocktail competitions and stuff like that, coming in saying like, this is the big idea. And then you go to it and it's really not that. But with the Circle, it certainly was. You know, it was a long process in the end with all the heats and then the global finals. But the whole thing, it was very clear. We were clearly being guided to think differently about whiskey and about cocktails and just approach everything from like a really fresh kind of perspective and creative viewpoint. And then the really nice thing was at the Circle, especially that last kind of week, we were all in London together with people from all over the world. It was such like a collaborative, lovely experience. I think it, you know, it didn't matter who was lucky enough to win in the end. Like, everybody was going to be so happy for that person. There's actually a video from the announcement of the final of the Circle, which if I'm having a down day, I just go back and watch, because it's just this moment. Like, I think it's just taken somebody's phone at the back of the room, but my name pops up on the screen. You can see me kind of collapse slightly, and plus the rest of the Circle just descend on me in a big hug. Yeah, it's a really sweet moment. I think it really kind of summed up what the Circle was like to be in as a bartender. Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, I love that, because I felt that in the room as well. Mm. I wasn't there with you for the whole of the final, and I didn't do any of the heats, but certainly that last evening, you're right, with that announcement, there was such a lot of support and love in the room. Yeah. And so yeah, the Circle is something that we forever expand. We've had two editions so far, and I just think if you've been part of that Circle in that way, you know, that's a bond that you have for a long time.
Yeah, definitely. And it was really interesting to see everyone's different approaches as well. We were given a few different tasks, so like tradition is half the story, and share and enjoy. And then where this whiskey ended up coming from in the global finals, we were asked to create a new whiskey idea. Like, we sat down with graphic designers and create our own labels and stuff like that. So we kind of come with these really off the wall ideas and try and get somebody to interpret it. And then we presented it to a room with, you know, John in, and I think you and Jill were there as well. And
somewhere in the back, yeah.
Yeah, we were the kind of people that know stuff about whiskey and about branding and all that kind of stuff. So I had this idea that I wanted to make a whiskey based on the color coral, which came from kind of initially the Pantone color of the year being living coral that year. And I'm a bit of a nerd, so I read about stuff like that. And the description of living coral, I mean, I'm paraphrasing here, but it was like earthy and warm, but vibrant at the same time. And it had like a connection to nature without being a green, you know, something obvious like that. And reading that, I was like, that sounds like a really good whiskey.
Right, yeah.
Warm, vibrant, earthy, so that kind of thing of something that's fresh and fun, but like comforting and lovely and a hug at the same time, you know. And so I pitched this idea for a drink based on coral. My initial pitch was almost the opposite of this. I had this idea for a really minimal label, just white with Helvetica, the Circle, and like a little pie chart in shades of coral with a kind of constituent flavour ideas, and but then like an empty box so people could put their own tasting notes in and stuff like that. Obviously we've moved away from that in the final design, but I'm delighted we have, because it looks mega.
It's got a real sort of visual warmth to it, I think. The way the circles interlock, because with the first circle as well, we had a similar sort of structure, the concentric for Rosie's whiskey. And this one, obviously so completely different in overall look and feel, but yeah, it still conveys this idea of concentric and connections and warmth and vibrancy as well.
Definitely, yeah. I think as well, like that the whiskey is also connected to Rosie's whiskey in a way, because we got to try Rosie's whiskey at the first ever like heat for this edition of the circle. And it was described to us as, this is a whiskey for drinking with friends on a sunny day, which is not something you hear a lot about whiskey. And so just like from the off, it's like this person who was won last time and was lucky enough to make this whiskey came to them with an idea that was not an idea normally associated with whiskey. So like straight off the bat, it was very much like, tradition is only half the story. Yeah.
Do with it what you will. So for me, not being synesthetic, coming to Mannie's idea with this notion of colour, so completely different to what we've ever done before. And so that's given us a lot of opportunities to play and not necessarily go down an expected route. And again, this is the beauty of blending. You can bring in so many different ideas, but also concepts and components to get you somewhere new. And so I think that's what the circle for me is, the first time I was able to participate in it on the whisky making side. That's what's been so wonderful about this. There's not necessarily an obvious starting point with whisky. An idea can come from anywhere. So of course, we've talked a lot about the process. We've talked a lot about the competition. And I think it's now time that we talk about the whisky.
So excited.
So here we go.
Thank you very much.
Very, very pleased with this one.
Very subtle little happy dance about that. It's been a while since I tasted it. We blended this a couple years ago now, but it's the first thing that I'm getting is just like all that lovely ripe fruit, which is generally speaking in my colour flavour library, kind of pinks and yellows and oranges. So straight off the bat, that nose, like we're already moving towards that living coral kind of thing.
Yeah, it does have a liveliness. So yeah, while I don't get that wonderful orangey pink that coral is, I do get that vibrancy and I do get that warmth. And I think the components that you helped us identify, you know, the bourbon cask matured Glenelgin is giving you heaps of that fruit. And then there's enough of the sherry cask action going on just to, again, provide that warmth, that spiciness. But also that sticky sort of dried fruitiness.
I think the color itself as well, and from the Pantone description, is that combination of vibrancy and then earthiness. And the kind of the top notes off the whiskey is really that vibrancy. And then as you kind of go deeper into it, that earth really starts to come out.
Yeah.
True sip.
Right. That is where the earthiness comes in for me as well.
Yep.
So it's 2% Ardmore, which is a medium peated Highland malt. And you were very, very keen when you tasted that for the first time. This is going to be a part of this blend. And so that has only at 2%, but it's stayed in there and it's providing you, I think, with that little hint of something else, that slight change of direction, that earthiness. But it also just helps to boost everything else, which
absolutely.
I think
absolutely. I think that one is that whiskey. We must have tried changing the amount of that by 1 mil, 0.25 of a mil or a percentage so many times until we hit 2% and it just seemed to make it all sing. I think it was almost, that whiskey was almost the thing that made the shape take color for me. It was quite amorphous and it just kind of wrapped it and said like, right, this is the thing now.
Yeah. And this was one of those wonderful moments where it taught me the value of what might look a very small percentage on the back label, but that can make such a difference. If it's a contrasting style, it can really help to accent or deepen. And so that was a great lesson for me that I learned thanks to you.
Oh, mate. I mean, the nice thing for me as well was I have nowhere near your Britannica of whiskies. And so when I could like describe a colour or a flavour and okay, we'll go and try a little bit of this, a little bit of this, and you know, 9 times out of 10 it was like, okay, that's exactly what I described. I was wrong, it's not what it means. And then quite often you'd be like, well, if you were saying this, did you really mean this? It's like, yeah, I think I did. I'm just getting now that the sherry influence, you know, get really giving it that kind of warmth that we always wanted to be a part of it.
Yeah.
And again, I think back to that little 2% of peated influence, that kind of almost creates a combination of like a campfire experience. It's not nearly as smoky as that, but that kind of experience of being by a heat source.
Yeah.
So warmth in a very kind of literal manner, almost, even though it's all happening up here.
Well, I want to thank you, Mannie, for bringing a really incredible idea to us and certainly expanding my mind about ways I can approach whiskey. The ways you can structure a recipe, the things you can bring in, which maybe don't always make sense at first, but come together really harmoniously. So that's been such a lot of fun with this product. And I also can't wait to see what our fans make of it. And I'd love for there to be some submissions of colors that everyone's getting. Maybe coral for you, but maybe someone else is getting something completely different. Turquoise, that'd be fun.
Absolutely. I'm just so excited to see this whiskey go out of the world after a couple of years of waiting. And yeah, this experience has been amazing. And I guess the most exciting part of it is that it's not over. Like, this whiskey's gonna go out there now, people are gonna try it and taste it and hopefully enjoy it. And I'm definitely gonna be one of those people that, rather than Googling my name, I'm gonna be Googling my whiskey to see what people say about it. And yeah, can't wait for that part of the process.
Absolutely.